Cycling aerodynamics is much discussed these days, but sometimes one gets the impression little understood. In fact, sometimes it's almost as though the cycling industry is using the word aero to try to sell us stuff that might not even make a difference. We recently made a video in Altabidia where I did a little experiment to measure the difference in speed with aero clip-on bars versus drops, and that reminded me just how complicated the aero topic is. And of course, you may have seen GCN's ill-fated, or that might even be ill-informed, attempts to deploy aerodynamic testing in a wind tunnel in Milan to make our commuter bikes faster. Anyway, we got lots of comments from you guys about that video and about how it wasn't very scientific, and we know that you are always right. So we thought, let's get properly stuck into the nitty-gritty, or maybe we should call that the airy-fairy, of aerodynamics. This is GCN's brief guide to aerodynamics. We are not claiming to cover every detail. In fact, there are plenty of experts to do that if you care to look them up in peer-reviewed journals. This is just a vague overview with a few equations and graphs. So first, who cares about aerodynamics anyway? Well, aerodynamics is a drag. Literally, it is a backwards force on you whenever you're moving. At a constant speed on the flat, so not accelerating and not uphill, aerodynamic drag takes up about 65 to 85% of your power. That's most of your power. The rest of your power goes on rolling resistance and friction, and the variation is due to differences in drag and friction between individuals and the different speeds. Aerodynamic improvements are sometimes referred to as free speed because you can go faster without putting out more power if you can make yourself more aero, which sounds pretty good to me. I mean, it's a simple win. Get aero, go faster, win. But the big question is always how to get more aero. Aerodynamics is unfortunately an annoyingly complicated science. There are lots of rules of thumb in cycling that are actually taken as rules often for how to get more aero and go faster. And those generalizations might often work, but not always. What works for one person on one position or even one set of weather conditions might not work for someone else. That's because the drag is dependent on local airflow, and the flow fields around a complex shape like a human on a bicycle are horribly difficult to compute. Even before you add in the movement of your legs, your cranks, your wheels, the only definitive way to test whether a piece of equipment or a change in position is faster is to do either a wind tunnel test or a well-instrumented field test, which, to be honest, is a bit expensive and quite a lot of hassle for most of us. So let's start with our equation for drag force, FD, our old friend drag force. This is actually what we want to reduce because it's opposing our motion. So FD, drag force. CD is your coefficient of drag. We'll come back to that later. A is your frontal area. Rho is your air density, and U is the relative wind speed. Relative being important because if you've got a massive headwind, then obviously your relative wind speed is higher than your speed, so it's harder. Similarly, if you have a massive tailwind, it's easier. So how do we go about reducing the drag force? Well, let's start on the right-hand side of the equation. We could reduce U, because the faster you ride, the more drag will work against you. And in fact, it's worse than that, because drag force increases with the square of your wind speed, relative wind speed. It's a non-linear relationship. So slowing down will make your drag force much lower. But that's kind of not the point of trying to cycle faster, is it? Slowing down to make your drag force lower. The point is that the faster you go, the more your drag force matters. So once you get up to 54 kilometers an hour, drag force is about 90% of the resistance, which is why getting aero is especially important, not just for time trialists, but also for sprinters. Actually, it's important for any cyclist who's going to win a race or simply go faster. It just makes more of a difference in terms of percentage of your exertion if you're on your own and you're going fast, because the faster you go, the more drag you have. So we could reduce U, but that's really not the point. That's kind of what I do now on my commute when I get tired and I just slow down. Next on the right, we have rho, air density. Now, lower air density means lower drag, but it's kind of hard to organise low air density on demand, and going to altitude where the air is less dense is a bit inconvenient for most of us. Not to mention the effect that altitude has on your breathing and your cardiovascular performance, which might mean that you actually go slower despite having lower drag. But that's why many cycling hour records have been attempted at altitude, because they have lower drag from air density. So that's not going to help us much. But now we get to frontal area. Now, this is what everyone thinks about when they want to get more aero, making themselves smaller in the wind, because the drag is directly proportional to the frontal area. So the smaller your frontal area, the lower the drag. Hence, we all want to get slammed. Now, it's worth noting that you can reduce your frontal area in more ways than just getting lower and getting slammed. So aero bars make your elbows narrower, which reduces your frontal area, and head position makes a huge difference. It takes a lot of discipline and strength to keep your neck cricked into an uncomfortable position so that your head is low and you can still see where you're going. I mean, actually, let's face it, it takes a lot of discipline and training to stick to any of these super tucked aero positions, as I'm sure Graham McBree would testify. Now, I should add here that the dots in the equation, they mean multiplied by, so that's like a multiplication symbol. Now to the drag coefficient. Let's deal with this last. This mysterious drag coefficient. I say mysterious because it really is very hard to predict. You can kind of guess whether it's likely to be good or bad, but for a complex shape like a cyclist on a bike, it's really a best an estimate. You have to measure it in a wind tunnel or on the road. So what is this drag coefficient anyway? Well, in simple terms, it's just a kind of measure of how streamlined an object is. And there are two main contributions to the drag coefficient. There's skin friction and form drag. So skin friction can be approximated to how rough something is. And to reduce skin friction, you want a nice smooth surface that's slippery to the air, like the super aero materials that are used for high-end time trial skin suits, or that aero gel that Lotto Soudal was recently found to be using in time trials. The aero improvements from shaving your legs, and in fact arms, if you dare, trust me, it's horrible, come from the reduction in skin friction of smooth versus hairy skin. Now, form drag, on the other hand, is about the shape of an object, and that's kind of tricky both to know what's best and then to make it happen, at least as a cyclist on a bike. So a teardrop shape is roughly what we're aiming for. The smoother you can make your body shape, the better. So if you can fill in the gaps, close up the front and rear ends, add a fairing, if you're allowed, behind your bum, anything that makes your shape smoother and more like a teardrop and avoids sort of loose flappy parts that increase turbulence, that will help. The really tricky thing is that sometimes frontal area and coefficient of drag work against each other. Not literally, but what I mean is that sometimes when you put all this effort into getting lower and lower with a smaller frontal area, your coefficient of drag could actually be higher because your body has formed a less smooth aerodynamic shape. And then your drag is higher, even though you're actually lower because your frontal area is lower. So you put all this effort into getting small, but you're not going any faster. That's really annoying. So in conclusion, the frontal area and the coefficient of drag are the things you can reduce to go faster for free. It's worth concentrating on getting the big things right first, making yourself small, but not so small that you can't pedal. But for example, keeping your elbows tucked in makes a difference. It doesn't cost any energy. You can use smooth, tight fabrics if you feel happy about your body shape, and try to make your position and your bike a smooth shape by filling in gaps. Oh, and work on holding your head low. It's probably the biggest factor in both frontal area and coefficient of drag. Well, I hope my aerodynamics lecturer from uni isn't watching, because I might have got something wrong, but I hope you find this useful. Why not check out Sinai doing an experiment in the wind tunnel in Milan, clicking down here, or you can see my clip on aero bars versus drops experiment in Alta Badia, down here.